Molt bé, doncs ara anem a temperar xocolata, que és un procés necessari per treballar la xocolata. Sempre que volem fer una peça artística, o volem fer un bombó, una rajola de xocolata, sempre hem de temperar la xocolata. Temperar la xocolata significa provocar que els cristalls cristal·litzin de la forma correcta perquè després l'acabat, el brillo, el trencar de la xocolata sigui el correcte. La cosa tradicional, avui el temperat es fa amb màquines, però de forma casolana i encara utilitzem l'obrador, la forma de temperar la xocolata és refredar-la sobre una superfície freda. Això és un marbre que té una temperatura freda. Llavors, aboquem aquesta xocolata que està a 45-50 graus sobre el marbre, però en deixem una petita part dins del perol. Aquesta petita part farà que després puguem aconseguir la resta temperat. Llavors, aquesta xocolata el que fem és escampar-la perquè es vagi refredant de forma homogènia. Llavors, quan tenim aquesta xocolata a uns 28 graus, l'ajuntem amb la resta, que està a aquests 45 graus, per aconseguir una mescla final de 30-31 graus, depenent de la xocolata. No amb totes les xocolates es tempera als mateixos graus. La xocolata negra normalment és les temperatures que he dit, i les xocolates amb llet o blanca és un pèl inferior la temperatura que hem de treballar. Llavors, quan en tenim això, el que fem és barrejar homogèniament les dues temperatures i teòricament, si ho he fet bé, el resultat final és una xocolata a 30-31 graus centígrads, que seria la manera òptima d'aconseguir una xocolata amb una forma cristal·lina 5. Bé, doncs el primer que podem fer quan tenim xocolata temperada és fer una rajola de xocolata. Si tenim un motlle, la distribuïm per dins la motlle. La vibrem. Ara això ho deixaríem refredar i al cap d'uns minuts tindríem una xocolata temperada que trencaria cruixentment i brillant.
So you've just seen remarkable chocolate creations from Enric Rovira. And now what we want to do is take a little bit of time and talk to you about the physics of chocolate. Now, as you will see, the discussion of the physics of chocolate is similar to the discussion of the physics of fats that we had a little bit earlier in this course, because chocolate, of course, is made primarily out of cocoa butter, which is itself a fat. You will recall that that cocoa butter, that fats, that is the fats that are in food, tend to be in the form of triglycerides. They have molecular structures that are like this. So they sort of have like two long arms that are stuck to a third arm, which is coming off on the end. And it's the interactions between such molecules that actually give rise to the phase behavior of fats. Cocoa butter, it turns out, which is the primary constituent of chocolate, is a very special kind of fat, and it has really very special properties. And so what we want to do right now is talk to you a little bit about what those properties are and to try to make it so that you love the properties as much as you love the chocolate. So a good way to start out and explain to you how unusual chocolate is as a material is just to take a piece of chocolate and to think about it a little bit and about the properties that you all know and love when you eat chocolate. And you saw this, of course, very much when you watched Enric. So chocolate has a couple of properties that I would like to highlight. One is that it is, of course, a solid. It is a solid that does not melt in your hand. The fact that it's a solid, you can tell because if you break it, it sort of snaps. There's a snap of chocolate that occurs when you take a nice piece of chocolate and break it. And that's sort of a typical characteristic of a solid. The other thing about chocolate is if you take a piece of it, as I now will, and put it in your mouth, then it melts in your mouth as you're eating it. And so if you think about it, it's really a very unusual situation. Chocolate does not melt in your hands, but it does melt in your mouth. You know, it's something like a 10-degree temperature difference between your mouth and your hands, but chocolate doesn't melt in your hands, but it does melt in your mouth, and that's really one of its essential properties. If we go back to our discussion before of fats and their melting behavior, then you will recall that different fats have different melting points. And the differences in the melting points we explained before by the molecular structure of the fats. We basically pointed out that fats could be either saturated or unsaturated, that saturated fats, you'll remember, pack together very well. The molecules stick to each other very strongly, whereas unsaturated fats were harder to pack and didn't stick as strongly, and therefore saturated fats had higher melting temperatures than unsaturated fats. Now, if you look at the molecular structure of chocolate, as I said before, it's a triglyceride. There are sort of three different acids that make up the three different arms of chocolate. There's palmitic acid and stearic acid, which are on the two side arms, and on the long arm is oleic acid. The side-armed acids are both saturated. Oleic acid is unsaturated, and it's the packing behavior of such molecules as a function of temperature that basically gives rise to the physics of chocolate, which I now want to discuss. Many fats actually have only one solid phase, but it turns out, and I'm going to try to explain to you what I mean by this, that cocoa butter, that is the fat that underlies chocolate, has actually six different solid phases. So this is the phase diagram of chocolate. So chocolate has, as I said, six crystalline phases that vary in temperature from 18 degrees to 36 degrees. So the lowest phase, which people call phase one, cleverly, has a melting temperature of about 18 degrees. The second phase, which people call phase two, is about 22 degrees. And then there are other phases. There's phase four, which is 34 degrees, and phase six, which is 36 degrees, and so on and so forth. And these are the six different phases. And in fact, it turns out that five and six are the ones that, and in particular, phase five is the phase that you need to hit in order to make the chocolate that you know and love and that we saw so spectacularly illustrated by Enric.